Hello, everybody. This is a wonderful, wonderful group. Once a teacher, always a teacher, and what I'm hoping both sides will hear today is some factual and some information of why the community is coming together or putting a group together. We're called Defending Our Ixonia Countryside. Please know we are so not against farms. We have an issue with the way CAFOs are growing and growing and growing and how it's coming about. So our goal is today to educate people. We are not going to get into a shouting match or anything. If you have questions, Gordon Stevenson will introduce himself and he will questions that he will answer at the end. I also have a book, which if you have not seen it, this was given to us by the Socially Responsible Agricultural Project. See if you can get through it, or at least get through a couple of pages and then pass it on. It might change the way you think about things as well. So, I'm sorry there aren't enough chairs, but we didn't expect this many people, so this is a really good thing. Gordon, are you all set?
Oh, I suppose so. Thank you.
This is Gordon Stevenson.
Well, there must have not been much of a game on this afternoon. Prettiest day since last October, and here we are sitting inside a room talking about manure. Well, I'm looking around the room here, and I see some old friends from yesteryear. I'm glad to see this looks an awful lot like a DNR hearing here. We've got folks that are for, folks that are against, and folks that are in the middle. So I tried to retire from that, but apparently I don't have sense enough to stay away. When I was asked to come to the town of Ixonia, I thought Ixonia must be some name that came from ancient Greece. So I Googled ancient Greece and couldn't find Ixonia anywhere. Being an engineer and lifelong nerd, I thought, well, Ixonia, maybe that's from Star Trek. There's the Klingons, the Romulans, the Ixonians. I checked the Star Trek website. No Ixonians there either. Everyone here but me probably knows the story about how Ixonia got its name, but I kind of like the story. This, in fact, is a very auspicious day for this particular town. Exactly 176 years ago, on February 12, 1841, the work was done to set up, to organize the government for this particular township. Soon after that, a local dispute ensued. And some of you probably know this story. People could not decide what to call this place. So in a remarkable display of democracy, fair play and creativity, it was decided to put the letters of the alphabet on slips of paper, put them in a hat, and they had the young daughter of the founder of this township, whose name was Mary Piper, her dad was Benjamin Piper, drew letters out of that hat until there was a name that people could recognize. The name that came out of that was Ixonia, drawn out of a hat. So, congratulations, Ixonia. A generation is 25 years long. You have existed for 7 generations, so good job. Well, I want to talk about CAFOs a little bit, and this is just a primer about CAFOs from my particular perspective. It is an acronym for concentrated animal feeding operation. Now, you will also hear the term confined animal feeding operation. I don't like to use that. One thing, it makes CAFO operators mad. They don't necessarily confine all their animals. So make sure you use concentrated animal feeding operations. The legal definition of concentrated animal feeding operation is extensive and confusing. But for purposes of our discussion today, suffice it to say that a CAFO is a large livestock operation that houses 1,000 animal units or more. Now, for example, 700 dairy cows or 1,000 animal units. A dairy cow is equal to 1.4 animal units. So that's not very interesting. I won't say more about it, but it's the way they're counted. Unfortunately, I don't have much good to say about CAFOs, and that's where I'm coming from, so truth in advertising here. CAFOs divide communities, put small farmers out of business, and make rural neighborhoods uninhabitable at large size, particularly. In this state, they have polluted lakes, rivers, streams, and wetlands. In this state, they have poisoned groundwater and water supplies. And the list could go on. I want you to take a look at this chart. It covers a time period from 1985 through 2014. You will note the rapid growth in the numbers of CAFOs in this state. When I first started working with CAFOs in 1985, that was 1 year after we got the law that could regulate CAFOs, there were only a handful of CAFOs statewide. And you might be interested to know that most of them were right here in Jefferson County. They were egg-laying operations. Some of you may recall the infamous Chicken Gate affair of Jefferson County. That ages me. Some of you probably know that. I want you also to note that we did not see large-scale dairies start to come in until 1995. And as you know, that's the purple bar that you see up there. And we're now sitting with about 220 dairy CAFOs in Wisconsin at about 40 more of other types of livestock. I have really three things I want to talk about today, messages. We are in the middle of a water quality crisis and public health crisis in Wisconsin. Agriculture is largely responsible for that, I'm sorry to say. And solutions are going to require some fundamental changes in our understanding of agriculture and what we assume about agriculture and what the actual role of agriculture has been in the state of water quality conditions in Wisconsin. We have three landscape scale water quality crises going on right now in this state. The dead zone in Green Bay, the nitrate contaminated groundwater of the Central Sands, and the nitrate and pathogen contaminated groundwater of Kewaunee County. And there are more. I just don't have time to talk about all of them. It is well documented that for all three of these cases, agriculture is the primary actor. For over a quarter century now, I have been involved with dozens of government programs, including local, state, and federal programs that have sought to improve the environmental performance of agriculture. All of those programs have had one thing in common. They have scrupulously avoided curtailing agricultural productivity and profitability. And that has been at our peril. And I'll explain that greater shortly. Despite that long rap sheet I just read to you about CAFOs and what problems I have with them, the first thing that we need to understand that, particularly in this state, we revere farmers and farming in general. CAFOs ride along under that positive cultural umbrella. We celebrate dairy farming with bucolic scenes embroidered on scenes we put on our walls. And we call ourselves cheeseheads, and we proudly emblazon our association with dairy on our license plate. We are the dairy state. And if I took a poll in this room, I have a feeling that at least half of you would identify yourselves as having come from farms just maybe one or two generations ago. I'm like that. There is an unspoken social contract, I'll call it, if you will, that perceives farming as wholesome, noble, and endearing. It may have been those things some years ago, and it still is that among many conscientious farmers that I know. But just look behind those embroidered scenes on the wall, and you can find a very different picture. Contaminated wells and manure-choked streams aren't good subjects for embroidery. Unfortunately, this is increasingly the legacy of livestock agriculture in this state. Concentrated animal feeding operations, like pulp and paper mills, like municipalities, are required to obtain something called a WPDS permit. But because pulp and paper mills are industry and do not enjoy that social reverence and piety that is extended to farmers, they are regulated much more rigorously than farms. And in fact, those pulp and paper mills have to regulate their discharges down to the nanogram. Now, a nanogram is roughly equivalent to a drop of gin in the Pacific Ocean of vermouth. So it's just an infinitesimal, tiny, tiny amount. While we regulate those discharges from pulp and paper mills down to the nanogram, the smallest measure of farm pollutants used by environmental regulators is in tons. Farms, both large and small, are undoubtedly the most protected group environmentally in this state, if not the nation. The environmental behavior bar that state and federal laws sets for agriculture is low. Understand that manure management technology has not changed fundamentally since the Middle Ages. That is, it is spread untreated onto the land surface. In the mid-1940s, there were twice as many cattle in Wisconsin as we have now. However, milk production is almost three times higher now than it was in the 1940s. Obviously, to make such great strides on productivity like that, there has been tremendous technological advances in animal genetics, livestock housing, livestock nutrition, and others. However, one thing has been fundamentally the same for a couple of thousand years: manure management. We may use tractors and mechanical spreaders instead of oxen and serfs, but the practice is the same. I don't know of any major industry that still uses a thousand-year-old technology. What has changed, however, is the sheer volume of manure that is spread on the landscape and the fact that most larger livestock operations now use liquid manure systems. These two changes have multiplied both the human health risks and the environmental risks associated with agriculture. Spring is here. I want you to take a look at those numbers. That's how many livestock, that's the livestock populations that we have in Wisconsin. Look at the first number. We have about 3.4 million head of cattle. And the bottom number, we're counting people as livestock, that's about 5.5 million people live in Wisconsin. We're going to talk about those numbers a little more shortly. While I worked at DNR, I frequently used this conversion. This is so people could get their heads around how much pollution potential, how much water pollution could in fact be caused by livestock, particularly cattle. And again, that idea is one cow equals 18 people. That conversion, by the way, is based on biochemical oxygen demand, which is a typical measurement of organic pollution potential. Okay, here's Tokyo, Japan. What's Tokyo got to do with this? Milwaukee has about 600,000 people. Madison has about 250,000 people. Those are our biggest cities. Tokyo has 37.6 million people, more than six times the entire population of Wisconsin. Arguably the second biggest city in the world after Tokyo is Mexico City. It has a population of 21 million people. Now, where am I going with this? Here's the punchline. Let's do a little bit of arithmetic here. If we take 3.4 million cattle, multiply it times 18 people per head of cattle, we will get a very rough equivalent of about 60 million people. That's the cattle that are housed in Wisconsin. Now remember, we have about 5.5 million actual people like us and 10 times more in an equivalent of cattle. And let's add up the populations of Tokyo and Mexico City. We come up with about 60 million people. Our cattle, you know, I'm going to entertain questions at the end. Thank you, sir. The bottom number there is the equivalent of people of those two cities, and that's equivalent to how many cattle we have in Wisconsin, at least in terms of organic pollution potential. Here's a football stadium near and dear to us. It's five stories high. I'm going to talk a little bit, not a lot, but a bit about Tag Lane Dairy. This is a five-story high Lambeau field, very large, a lot of space. While I don't have specific numbers of how many animals are currently housed at Tag Lane, I'm going to take a rough estimate of about 1,500 head. And at that population, you could fill up Lambeau Stadium over a year's time, all the way up to the fifth story bleachers. Now, because of the depression of milk prices that have been that's been going on a while, a lot of dairies, including CAFOs, are considering expansion in order to remain profitable. Understand too that Tag Lane is smaller than many of the CAFOs in Wisconsin. Some of them now exceed 10,000 head. They need to fill up Lambeau Field several times a year to account for all the manure and wastewater generated on their facilities. In terms of human population, a 1,500 head CAFO exceeds the population of Stevens Point, Wisconsin. So realize that the farm, possibly as it sits now, is generating the same amount of waste as the people of Stevens Point. Now, if that same CAFO wishes to double in size, you're going to be sharing the lacrosse experience. I like that postcard. It has 50,000 people, over 50,000 people. That's how much a 3,000 head CAFO would be equivalent to. Manure contains a long list of pollutants, including pharmaceuticals, heavy metals, oxygen-depleting organics, and others. But the big three, or dirty three, at least for Wisconsin, are the two crop nutrients up there, nitrogen and phosphorus. Crops need those for growth, I hope everyone understands. And human disease-causing pathogens, and none of us need those. These include both surface water and groundwater. The wild card in water quality protection and agriculture in Wisconsin is the oceanic volume of liquid animal waste that is produced in this state. And the wild card is also that rural communities now face the specter of a 10,000 head dairy operation that might move in next door to them with impunity. Now, I talked about water quality, and I'll continue to talk about water quality because that's where my expertise lies. I do want you to understand something, though. There are no air regulations that apply to agriculture, not to CAFO nor to anyone else in agriculture. There are things on the books, they are not enforced. From the early fall of 2005 through the midsummer of 2006, Wisconsin experienced an unprecedented number of manure runoff events with water quality impacts. While there were more than 50 reported major events, it did not include an undoubtedly larger number of unreported events that we did not find. I want you to note that the green area, I hope you can see it, says land spreading, 75%. Causes of manure runoff events, well contaminations, etc. during that period, most of it had to do with land spreading of liquid manure. And that's the place where we really need to go to be vigilant. And also remember that that's a result of the deployment of a 2,000-year-old technology. A little more history here. Between 1830 and 1860, hundreds of Wisconsin residents died of epidemics of waterborne illnesses, such as cholera, that resulted from the lack and management and treatment of human waste. There were no sewage treatment plants at the time, and in communities where people were concentrated, sewage was simply released into the street. It was cheap, dangerous, and medieval. Epidemics like those were the genesis for development of sewage treatment plants, management, and public health. Understand that most CAFOs do not own sufficient acreage for spreading that big volume of manure that is produced in this state. They depend primarily on land owned by others. I do hope that landowners who are approached by CAFO operators understand that when manure is spread in the wrong place, at the wrong time, or at the wrong rate, fish can be killed, wells can be contaminated, and people can get sick. These events can trigger enforcement actions and possible civil penalties, and potentially incur significant financial liability. On a statewide basis, I know that some CAFO operators have told their future landowning clients not to worry about things like liability or runoff. If you are a landowner and you are told that, I suggest that you ask your attorney to see if he or she concurs. The point I want to make here is that the wholesale disposal of untreated liquid animal manure, like the early 1830s to 1860s of human waste, is cheap, as a cheap, dangerous, and medieval practice. And it is time for that practice to stop. One of my messages today, obviously, was about the water quality and public health crisis. And I want to talk a little bit about the dead zone in Green Bay. That, and I'm not talking about the city of Green Bay, the body of water of Green Bay that runs from Green Bay out into Lake Michigan. It has a dead zone, just like the dead zone that exists at the mouth of the Mississippi River where it drains into the Gulf of Mexico. A dead zone is an aquatic biological desert that is devoid of life. Going to go a little techie here. To grow crops, plants need nitrogen, phosphorus, potassium, a lot of other things, but those are the three major crop nutrients. Farmers apply those nutrients from chemical sources, but also from animal manure. Hypoxic, fancy $3 word up there. That means a condition of low dissolved oxygen in a body of water. The federal standard for hypoxia is a concentration of dissolved oxygen at a level greater than 5 milligrams per liter. As the chart indicates, there's not a lot of historical data to reference. Note that there were 4 hypoxic days observed in Green Bay in 1990. By 2011, the number of hypoxic days had grown to 43. These data strongly suggest that hypoxic conditions in that water body are worsening. On the base of peer-reviewed science and what I read, the causes of that dead zone are primarily from agricultural runoff. And I will go out on a limb here and specifically say because of the concentration of livestock in that basically lower Fox River Basin, that most of that excessive phosphorus is likely from manure sources. I'd be happy to be proven wrong about that, by the way. What you see in red there is where there isn't any oxygen in the water. Nothing can live there. It runs from Green Bay almost all the way up to Marinette. It's a large area. Moving on to the Central Sands, that's right in the middle of the state. We're talking about places like Adams, Juneau, Washera, Waupaca, parts of Sauk, etc. They are characterized by highly permeable, coarse-textured sandy soils. Pollutants can easily infiltrate through those soils. The groundwater is already extensively contaminated in the Central Sands with nitrates, and that's from agricultural activity. As I said, there's already extensive contamination from chemical sources. Certainly the widespread of irrigation agriculture is basically a player in driving this material down to the groundwater. 17 to 26% of the wells throughout the Central Sands on average exceed the 10 milligram per liter drinking water standard for nitrate. And in some parts, not too many of them get caught. DNR is woefully understaffed. For many, many years, they were lucky if DNR staff got to a farm once in a 5-year permit period. So the quick answer to your question is no, DNR is not monitoring it.
But the farmers are required to do
reports.
They're
required to do it. Most of them do.
Okay, yeah, okay. Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, I got a question. You kind of seem down on these farms. But what about this sludge that comes out of Milwaukee where they're replacing the pipes because of the lead in the pipes? It's entering their sewage system. How do they take that lead out before they come out and put it on the neighboring farms around here?
I don't know. I can't answer that.
Don't you think this lead...
You're talking about like Milorganite or the sludge trucks that come
yeah,
around?
Yeah, but lead has been a proven factor with birth defects. Mm-hmm. But yet we're taking this on our fields in our area.
Yeah,
I think you want to be down on the farmer, but this is a bigger problem because of all the hospitals and all the disease that's put into the sanitary system. How is that removed and not brought out here?
I do not have expertise on what the current state of the sludge management program is, but for Milwaukee, what I can tell you is we do have landowners, sometimes they will get some manure from a CAFO. That CAFO will give them enough manure to grow the crop that landowner says they want. The same landowner will take some sludge from Milwaukee or someone else, get paid for it. They'll take some more sludge from some waste whey from the cheese factory.
Yeah, with those 18 people that are pooping and complaining about one cow, look at the people in Milwaukee, one of your larger cities, and we're bringing it here with more disease than these cattle.
I can tell you this, Milwaukee has a sewage treatment plant. They had, as the gentleman pointed out, they had a big problem, but they've got a sewage treatment plant. They are required to. When they had their big problem, they were in violation. What I can tell you now is that CAFOs don't have to have a sewage treatment plant. So I could actually get that conversion factor up higher if I were looking at people. The BOD that they would have under a sewage treatment plant for people would be much less. We'd be at 40 or 50 people for Cal if I was actually telling an honest game. Yes, ma'am.
According to the newspaper, we were meeting today to get more information about CAFO and some type of voting. Are we past the voting? Can we still vote? Or who gets to vote?
There's no
voting? Okay, so we...
It's not about voting. Ultimately, I guess it is, like I was saying, we need to start electing people that believe in peer-reviewed science, to think water quality for the next seven generations is a more important idea than profitability for a handful of entrepreneurs for one generation.
Right.
In terms of CAFOs, the way you can weigh into the process, let us say that one of the local CAFO dairies decides to expand. They go through a reissuance of their permit. There are a number of opportunities for public hearings. There are opportunities for appealing decisions from public hearings all the way up through the court system. That does not happen very often. It is happening right now with a few CAFOs, and I'm involved with a couple of those marginally. That's the way it works. So it's not like, let's all decide if we want this CAFO or not. It doesn't work that way.
Question.
Yes, ma'am.
Would it be possible to institute some sort of regulations that they would have to treat the manure that they're spreading?
There have been some proposals like that. One CAFO has, in fact, installed a treatment system some years ago. He did that to save money on diesel fuel because he didn't want to have to haul it all. That was when diesel was over $4 a gallon. It's now cheaper. He's abandoned his treatment system and gone to land spreading. That's possible. It will mean a completely new waste management system without a current infrastructure for the livestock industry, and there would be a lot of discussion before that would come to fruition. Yes, sir.
One of the things I think people need to understand is that CAFOs cannot just go spread manure anywhere. there are restrictions based on slope, based on proximity to waterways, based on proximity to rivers, any open water. So it isn't like they can go spreading anywhere. You have to understand that there are significant regulations to that. Plus, they do need to have their soil tested so that they can find out, based on where their soil test level is and what crop removal would be, there is a certain window for the amount of manure that can be applied. And they do have to keep extensive records. And those records are submitted to the DNR for people to look at them. And the DNR knows how much manure they have, and they know how much land they have to apply it to. So if somebody is not compliant, the DNR can come out and find them.
What they don't do, however, is monitor water. They monitor crops, as you pointed out. Yes?
Yes, I'm Lisa Conley. I represented the Wisconsin Association of Lakes and sat on the rule writing committee for 590. And I can tell you that, you know, you have a lot of people around the table. You have water quality people, you have ag people and all. And the resulting rules are a compromise. And what Gordon is saying is the rules that we came up with, and they've been revised since I was on that committee, are not adequate. And we're, you know, maybe the farms are doing okay, but the water is not, and there's big problems. And I'm deeply concerned. I was on a tour of some CAFOs in two CAFO tours in Kewaunee County. One was by the at some of the big dairies that showed us how well they were managing things. And then another was by the people who were showed us dairies that were never given a permit because there's such a backlog, and the enforcement isn't there because there aren't enough people in the DNR to the DNR budget has been cut, the staff has been cut, they can't get the permits out fast enough, they can't inspect often enough, the enforcement just isn't adequate to get the water.
Yes.
So you worked for the DNR for a long time, and you were very well involved with CAFO permits and issuing them, correct?
Sure.
So from what I kind of looked up before I came to this meeting, I kind of learned that you were one of the first people to, I think you actually issued the first one.
I issued the very first WPDS permit.
So
it was really defective.
Okay, but you were part of that process.
Absolutely.
And now you're sitting here
Let me tell you a little story. A lot of this is my fault. Absolutely. Let me tell you a story. You know, I talked about the little girl in Kewaunee County got so sick. Soon after that event, I met her parents. Let me put it this way. I don't think I've seen as much anxiety, fear, or anger in anyone's eyes as I saw in the eyes of those parents. They had turned to their county for help. They turned to their township for help. They turned to the state of Wisconsin. They turned to DNR. All of us failed her. I failed her too. I have a grandson. He's about the age of now that little girl was then. And I hope no one fails him. There was nothing I could do. That little girl got hit by pathogens, and that the permit did not have a pathogen limit. And that, among other things, was one point where you continue to try to improve those rules. And while I was at DNR, I tried to improve those rules. Understand that, one, you work for the boss, and two, that there are programs that are out there that may or may not align with sensibilities of every staff member that's out there. But I know the point you're making.
Hard for me to sit here and listen to you after you just were a lot in those processes and helped.
I did.
Those CAFOs get permits. So it's really hard for me to
understand. Yes,
I just want to say one thing to everybody that's here. Our purpose in holding this meeting is to educate people. It's for us to maybe get a different perspective on what we believe, maybe get another a side of things or whatever. I think the bottom line is, and everybody will agree with this, we want clean water, we want clean air, we want land that's not contaminated, and we want to work together. Anybody disagree with that? Okay, so let's take what Gordon said, let's not twist it, let's not use it to be greedy and get more than we need, and let's go away from this and try to somehow make things better. Thank you, Gordon. Wonderful job.